Hello chess friends and welcome to the channel. Yesterday the news of Arianne Caoili's death was the first thing that I read when I woke up, and it was really like a punch in the face, completely drained my energies because I felt too sad to make the video. And I think like many other fans around the world, I still feel pain for this tragic event. In today's video, we have episode 18 of the Kasparov series. The year is 1981. Kasparov is playing at a very interesting tournament, a match between the four official Russian teams. And we have the first Russian team with Karpov and all the other giants, the second Russian team, the U team, and the senior team. Despite the friendly nature of the tournament, there were sharp and uncompromising fights that it's very nice to watch together. We will begin with the game Kasparov versus the strong grandmaster and theoretician Oleg Romanishin. This game was played in round 1. Let's get started. Garry Kasparov with the white pieces opens with d4. Romanishin answers with knight to f6. Now c4 and g6. After knight to c3, we have d5, the Gruenfeld. Now c captures on d5, the knight recaptures on d5, and now e4 attacking the knight comes with tempo. Knight captures on c3, the b-pawn recaptures on c3, and bishop to g7 completes the fianchetto, also putting pressure on d4. This is the theme of the Gruenfeld, at least in the first moves. Here comes knight to f3. c5, even more pressure on d4, bishop to e3, protecting the pawn, and now queen to e5, pinning c3. With queen to d2, Kasparov unpins c3, knight to c6, even more pressure against d4, and of course this pawn cannot advance because there is this terrible bishop in fianchetto that would capture on c3, winning the game. So at least rook to c1 with the rook away from this dangerous diagonal, c captures, and now queen captures on d2. The king recaptures on d2. In order to keep his powerful pawn center, Kasparov has the king in the center, and only the next moves will show if this hazard is justified or not. Short castle for black, and what happens now if white continues with seems the natural bishop to b5. Let's watch this move first. If now bishop to b5, not played by Kasparov, black answer f5 is strong because he's threatening to play f4, winning the bishop that is trapped. So here white is forced to capture on f5. He captures, bishop captures, and in this line black scores very well, almost better than white. So that's why after short castle, Kasparov doesn't continue with bishop to b5, but with d5, attacking the knight. Rook to d8 is defending the knight, pinning the pawn. King back to e1 unpins the pawn, and now knight to a5 seems a strange position for the knight, but also Kasparov praised this move because now the knight is controlling c4, the square where this light square bishop would really like to move. Bishop to g5, attacking e7, and now bishop to f6. He changing the bishop on f6 doesn't give anything to white. Let's watch why. Because after bishop captures on f6, there is e captures on f6, and f5 will come, and f5 is strong and will equalize the game. So after bishop to a6, bishop back to d2, but this maneuver, with this maneuver, black now has the bishop on f6 that at least is blocking this f5 push. Here comes b6, good move, and rook to c7. Now, in the fight for the initiative, Kasparov not only has the king in the center, but is also neglecting the king side development. But in this complex position, general rules don't apply. It's just a matter of calculation and positional evaluation. Romanishin continues with bishop to g4 that completes his development, but it was much better to oppose the rook with the rook to d7. Here comes bishop to a6, controlling c8, and of course developing the bishop, and now e6, attacking the most advanced pawn. Knight to g5 is a good move, now f7 is under attack, Black can't capture with the bishop the knight. Let's watch what happens. Now, bishop captures on g5, not played by Romanishin, that really is a strong player. It's a mistake because after bishop captures on g5, this recapture comes with tempo, and attacking the rook, white wins the tempo that is necessary to make the d pawn a pass pawn, and not only that, a winning pass pawn. Now, if rook to e8 to save the e-change, here comes d6, and this pawn will win the game. Let's go back to our game. So that's why after knight to g5, here comes bishop to e5, with the bishop that is controlling d6. So, rook captures on f7, and now e captures on d5. f4 attacking the bishop. Bishop back to g7 is good, because the bishop is interfering with this rook capture on h7. And now f5. Also f6 is in the cards. Here comes d captures on e4. And now Kasparov continues with the best move, that is bishop captures on a5, removing this knight that was controlling the c4 square. But before playing this move, there are some important lines to consider, to evaluate. Let's go back one move. Now after d captures on e4, f6, that looked good and was in the cards, now loses, because there is bishop captures on f6 first, of course, not to lose this bishop for free. After rook captures on f6, there is e3 that is attacking the bishop, or the bishop captures, or the bishop moves away. There is rook to d1 we check, that will win this rook on h1. And this is the threat that Kasparov must always keep in mind. Let's go back to our bishop captures on a5. So we said best move, not f6, that we just saw that is losing. But what happens now if black plays now rook to d1 we check, not played by Romanishin? Rook to d1 we check is still one of the best answers, but white is okay now, because let's watch what happens. After king to f2, rook captures on h1. Now bishop to c4 with the terrible discovered threat. The king can't move, because if now king to h8, it's checkmate, there is f6. So let's go back to our bishop to c4. We said there is no time to move the king. So best move now is rook to c1, so attacking the piece that will give the discovered check. But in this position, white still has two good resources. At first, we will evaluate the simple rook captures on a7 with the discovery check. Now, of course, this rook must capture on c4. The white rook captures the rook on a8, we check. Bishop to f8, and now bishop captures on b6. Bishop captures on f5. Knight captures on h7 is the best move, because the king is also protecting this bishop. This bishop now is under attack. King captures, rook captures on f8, white is a pawn up. In this position, rook to c2 we check is good, but doesn't regain the pawn, because after king to g3, this position there is a small advantage for white, because black can't lose time winning this a2 pawn. Watch what happens if now rook captures on a2. There is bishop to d4, now rook to h8 is checkmate, only move to prevent checkmate is g5, and the bishop is lost. So, let's go back to our king to g3, this is the position where white is a pawn up and a bit better, but still a difficult endgame. Let's go back to our rook to c1, we said that in this position white has two good resources. The first one that we just watched is rook captures on a7 with the discovery check. The other one is to bring back the bishop to b3. Now rook to f8, of course, is the best move. Bishop to d2, attacking and saving this bishop and attacking the rook. Rook to b1, and now f6. Of course, now the threat is rook captures, we check. So rook captures on f7, bishop captures, we check, king to f8, f captures on g7, we check, king captures on g7, now the bishop moves back to b3, the e4 pawn is lost, another difficult endgame where white still has some advantage, maybe a bit better than the other line for white. Let's go back to our game. We said Kasparov played bishop captures on a5, was controlling the important c4 square, where Kasparov would like to put his bishop, but this move is good only after we consider all the lines that begin with rook to d1 we check, winning the rook on h1, but because these lines are still a bit better for white, probably Romanishin decides to capture with his b-pawn on e5, but this is not the strongest answer. So now in this position Kasparov continues with bishop to c4, with an x-ray attack against the king. Here comes bishop to c3 we check, and now king to f2, e3 we check. If Kasparov captures here the pawn on e3, there is the skewer. So king to g3, and now bishop to e5 we check. King captures the bishop on g4, rook to d4 we check is a fork in order to remove this dangerous bishop. King to h3, and now rook captures on c4. Here comes f6. Kasparov is preparing the mating net. Let's make a free move. Let's play, for example, e2. If e2, there is rook to g7, we check. King to f8, knight to e6, we check. King to e8, and rook to e7 is checkmate. Now, of course, if the king moves toward the corner, giving checkmate is even easier. So, let's go back to our game. f6 is to prepare the mating net. So, unfortunately, Romanishin must sacrifice the bishop to prevent checkmate. Bishop captures on f6. Rook captures on f6. Kasparov is a piece up, but the game is not over yet. Here comes rook to b8 behind the passed pawn. Rook to e1 occupies the e1 square, so the promotion square. And here comes e2. King to g3, moving toward the center. Rook to a4, and now king to f2. Rook captures on e2, wins the pawn, clears the e-file, and is protecting e2. Here comes knight to e6, good idea, this maneuver that is also an interference. Now a4, this is the only counterplay for black. Now rook to b1, with the idea to still give checkmate, is a mistake. Let's go back one move. In this position, knight back to d4, and e-changing here on e2 is the best idea. Let's go back to our game. Rook to b1, the idea of course is to play rook to b7, is a bad idea. In this position, black can equalize the game. Here comes a3, rook to b7, and now e1, we check with the promotion, and we check, of course, is forcing the king to capture. And now this rook captures on g2. Rook to g7, we check. King to h8 is forced. Now the second. The same rook moves to f7, and of course this rook to f8 will lead to checkmate. So here comes h5 to clear h7 for the king. King to f1, attacking the rook. This is the really decisive moment of the game. There is only one move that saves black, but this is move 40, but only for the white player. Black, with little time on the clock, Romanishin must play the last move before the time control without too much time to think, and this move is very important. He continues with the rook captures on h2, but this is a blunder. Let's go back one move. In this position there is only one idea that can save black. The idea begins with a2, of course with the idea of promoting this pawn. Now of course white can't capture the rook or it loses the game. So here comes rook captures on a7, but now rook captures on h2, because this pawn can advance, and of course this is the classic tactic in this pawn and rook end game. So if a1 with the promotion, the rook captures, here comes rook to h2, we check, the king must move away, and black recaptures the rook. Now, rook captures on h6 to interfere, but again, here comes a1 promoting to queen, we check, rook captures on h1, we check, rook to g1, rook captures, king captures, rook captures on e6, and incredibly, black was able to draw this game, because of course this pawn also on the h-file, so also in on the worst file for the rook and pawn endgame, so this game is a complete draw. Let's go back to our game. Instead, after king to f1 attacking the rook, at move 40 and without time on the clock, Romanishin captures with the rook on h2. And this is a blunder because Kasparov's mating plan becomes a reality. Now, rook captures on g6, rook captures on e6, because of course any other move will lead to checkmate. Let's go back one move. For example, if black continues with a2, this doesn't work because it's checkmating too. Rook to h6, we check, king to g8, rook to g7, already checkmate. So, going back to our game, after rook captures on g6, black must continue with rook captures on e6. Now, rook captures on e6 and king to g8 attacking the rook. Rook captures on a7 and with the threat of rook to e8 checkmate, Romanishin resigns. Let's give this checkmate. If black continues with king to f8, controlling e8, there is rook to c6, so now the checkmate threat is on c8. Now, rook to h1 we check, and white must pay attention to not play rook to g2, sorry, king to g2, but king to f2 with the king that is protecting e1. Because if not, the black rook will move to e8 and will shield his king. Now, after king to f2, there is rook to h2, we check, king to e3, controlling e2, rook to h3, we check, king to f4, controlling e3, rook to h4, we check, king to f5, controlling e4, no more checks, and nothing can stop this checkmate on c8. So, in my opinion, this game was really a fantastic game, and I hope that you also liked it. If you did, please don't forget to like the video and to subscribe to the channel. I thank you very much for watching and see you tomorrow. Goodbye!